We're going to be discussing some specific roles for nuclear science in management of the marine environment. The emphasis is going to be on how nuclear and isotopic techniques are improving global understanding of coastal processes.
Thank you, and I'd like to thank the IAEA for giving me the opportunity to talk about the application of nuclear techniques to the study of storm surges, tsunami, and you can use it also for sea level rise. On the 11th of March 2011, a tsunami generated by the magnitude 9 earthquake on the Japan Trench struck Japan. It's called the Tohoku-oki tsunami, and it affected nearly 2,000 kilometers of coast in Japan, and it inundated up to 5 or 6 kilometers inland. The death toll was nearly 19,000 people, 16,000 dead, and almost 3,000 missing. The estimated cost was $300 billion. Now, in some areas, like here on the Sanda Plain, the land subsided or dropped down because of the earthquake, up to about 1 meter. And so it made the tsunami worse because the water was much higher and it could go even further inland. If you look at the tsunami coupled with land subsidence, it actually mimics the effect of very rapid sea level rise on the shoreline. This photo here is actually very relevant to my work because it shows that's where we worked. We worked along the transect from the shoreline, past the runway. You see on the right-hand side, you have the runway of the Sanaa Airport, and we went on over 4 kilometers inland. The tsunami deposited a deposit. And the deposit was not very thick, actually. It ranged in thickness from about 30 centimeters near the coast on the left to about 1 or 2 millimeters on the about 5 kilometers inland. The deposit was first just sand, then further inland it was sand dominated with some mud, and further inland it was just mud dominated. The limit of the recognizable sand deposit, which is like 5 millimeters, was 2.8 kilometers inland. Now, because it's very easy to see in a sedimentary record, it's what geologists have been using to determine or estimate the magnitude of the tsunami and the generating earthquakes. But as you can see here, the sand stopped about 2.8 kilometers inland. The tsunami went another almost 2 kilometers. So using the extent of sand results in the magnitude of the tsunami and the earthquakes being underestimated. Now you're going to tell me, how are you going to recognize this mud deposited by the tsunami from the mud it's deposited in, the terrestrial mud? There you hardly have any marine macrofossils. Sometimes you find them, but there they were known. Now you know the tsunami comes from the sea, and it left lots of salt behind. So I didn't bring a salt shaker because I think you all know what salt looks like. And all these white stains there, they're just salt crust at the top of the mud 2 months after the event, about 3 kilometers inland. And this graph here shows you the concentration of chlorine, which is a component of salt, from the shore to about 5 kilometers inland. And the darker area in the middle between about 1.5 and 3.5 kilometers inland is where there were most of the salt was deposited. So you can use chemical fingerprinting to identify this mud that was deposited by the tsunami. Now, on the right-hand side, there I drew a line between two points you can hardly see, but one has a higher concentration than the other. That's the site here in May, and towards you is the land, and you go towards the sea in the background. See, the land has been plowed. There's no debris, no evidence that tsunami has ever been there, except for the chemical signature. There was more salt on the right than on the left, and there's a little ditch in the middle. That's as far as the tsunami went. And it fits the extent that had been mapped by the researchers that came just after the tsunami went and mapped the extent of the tsunami using debris and water marks. So here's the limit of the tsunami. As you can see, the sand went 60%, the mud went about 95% of the inundation. So you can use chemical fingerprinting to identify the true extent of tsunami inundation. And you can also use it to redraw paleo tsunami inundation maps. It's valid for Japan, it's valid for anywhere else in the world. Now you're going to tell me, why is it important? Why do we do that? We always ask a question, how big or often? We know that Japan has been affected by tsunami in the past. And here there's a trench that was recently dug in Iwanuma near Sendai. And you can see a number of layers. Of course, I show you here sand into soil, because if I showed you a photo of mud into mud, it's not very photogenic. It's black and black and black. So I'm showing you that example. And you see sand layers between and soil in between. At the top, you have the Tohoku Oki tsunami. Fin here is probably the 1611 Keicho. Here we have the 869 Jogen. And we have the Toada Tefra here. That's the yellow layer. Now, what we do, we can use nuclear technique like AMS with a half-life of 5,730 years to look at the timing of this event, these very old events. More recent events, you can use lead-210 as a half-life of 22.3 years. I know lead-210 is better for up to 100, 150 years. It was just an example here. In Japan, in the northern part, there'll be event in the last 100 years, so you can use lead-210. Now, in Japan, there's a very long historical record, so you can actually use this to test our nuclear techniques. Now, in Australia, where I live, the historical record is very short. It's just 200 years. So we have to rely on these nuclear techniques to go back in time. In Australia, we're so lucky, we don't get affected by that many tsunamis. There's some on the northwest side coast, the tsunami generated by the Indian Ocean, and there's a few others. But we don't get affected by many large tsunamis. Well, we get affected by our cyclones. And here there's Tropical Cyclone Yasi in February 2011 is a Category 5 cyclone, which is the highest category for cyclones. Now, the coast in northeast Queensland is not as densely populated, but it caused lots of damage. And the estimated costs were $3.6 billion. This photo here shows you gravel and sand that had been picked up by the storm surge at the time of the cyclone from the beach and the near shore and dumped on the top of the beach ridge. So again, the question arises, you know, how big or often? Now, with climate change, events are likely to be maybe not more intense, but we're likely to have more. So the more we know, better it is. So what we did, we dug a hole through that beach ridge, because it's what we do as geologists, we dig holes. And you can see you got sand layers separated by soil layers. The top one here is Tropical Cyclone Yasi from 2011. And below we have Tropical Cyclone Larry 2006. And we got eyewitness records of these events. People told us they happened. They know how far they went. And below we have Tropical Cyclone Winifred from 1986. Below we have the Innisfail Tropical Cyclone of 1918. So for this we need to use nuclear techniques so we can go back in time, so we can understand better the timing and the frequency of these events and what the impact was on the shoreline and how the shoreline or the coastline responded to these events. In a coastline which is sedimentary-rich, you got formation of beach ridges, and the record is preserved, so you can study it. And here, for example, this beach ridge is probably the one in the middle, the 5 to 8. So you can study this event, you can go back in time. And this work is fairly urgent because we need it to be able to improve our management strategies. The government needs this information, and so do the insurance industries. Thank you very much.
Thank you.